Hi, I'm Owen Dell of County Landscape and Design.
I'm Billy Goodnick with City of Santa Barbara Parks and Recreation Department. We're here to introduce a new show on sustainable landscaping.
We're the Garden Wise Guys.
You're a wise guy, eh?
Yeah. Right. Over the course of this quarterly show, we're going to show you everything that you need to know about planning, installing, and maintaining a thriving garden that will look great and protect the environment.
That's what a sustainable landscape is. It's in balance, it's easy maintenance, and it's easy on the planet.
Today we're at a garden that showcases a mix of plants that go well together. But they're not just thrown together like emptying out your sock drawer. There's a specific method to planting the right plant in the right place.
That's right. We're also going to take you to some other gardens in Santa Barbara and share the wisdom of the Garden Wise Guys. Ready to go?
Let's go.
Let's go.
All right. In this episode, we're going to discuss everything you need to know from A to Z about picking plants for your garden. We call it right plant, right place. So our lovely spokesmodel, Billy, will talk to us about the four key concepts of right plant, right place. Concept number one.
Drum roll, please. Size and spacing. Is there enough room for the height of the plant and the diameter of the plant to fit in the space you want to put it without ever having to prune it?
Concept number two.
Sun and shade. These succulents just love a little bit of sunshine, whereas this Mondo grass over here is much happier in a little bit of shade. Find the right spot for each plant.
Concept number three.
Soil type. Some plants love a nice, fast-draining sandy soil. Others get along just fine in our heavy clay soils. Pick the right plant for the right soil.
Concept number four.
Water requirements are what the zany landscape types like to call hydrozones. We have lawn that gets frequent shallow irrigation. We have large shrubs that require infrequent, really deep irrigation. Oh, and we're up here in the foothills behind Santa Barbara, a real rustic site, a lot of chaparral and oaks, and looking at this fabulous view of the ocean here.
This is a complete redo. We're taking this apart almost entirely. We're removing plants today. We have a crew here taking things out. And then the bulk of the landscaping needs to really work with what's really truly here. Drought-tolerant things, things that are heat-tolerant, wind-tolerant, less flammable than what you might use down in town. All these factors and a lot more have to come into the design process.
So you're working in a landscape that's been here for a long time. Part of it seems like remnants of what was here before any of us showed up and civilized the area. Others look like plant choices that were made, 10, 15, 20 years ago. And here you're trying to refresh things and start over again. So how do you approach what to keep and what to get rid of? I would imagine site analysis really plays a key role at the beginning.
There have been some decisions made here in the past, like the pepper trees that got too big. They were meant to screen a house, and they ended up screening the view as well. So we look at all the problems. We try to eliminate as many as we can.
So then do you just go out and start buying plants and sprinkling them around
here? That would be nice if it was that simple.
Wouldn't it?
That's what I call the Saturday morning syndrome. You go out, you go to the nursery, you see a neat plant, it's all blooming, and it's cheap, and you buy three of them, and you come home, and you walk around with them looking for a place to put them. And so you end up with the one of each syndrome, which is a little of this, a little of that. It doesn't really add up. It doesn't really make any sense, but that's what happened. That's the kind of stuff we end up tearing out.
We've really got three major goals. Everybody wants their landscape to be beautiful, but it also needs to be functional. As you're talking about, you need spaces to live outdoors and take advantage of our beautiful climate here. And the last thing is that it has to be sustainable. So I think we should encourage people from time to time to really stand back, be a little less emotional about the plants that are in your yard, and say, where can I really start? And it might be a little more money today to take it all out and put in a new system. But the savings of time, as we're going to talk about with all the sustainable principles, the saving of resources, having plants that thrive with little or no care, that's really what sustainable landscaping is all about.
80% of the cost of an average landscape is maintenance. 20% is design and construction. 80% is the care of that landscape over a design life of, say, 20 years. Water, labor, hauling stuff away. Most of that 80% is due to bad design. Things that got too big, things that need too much water, things that get pests and diseases. First, you see what's really here. You analyze it carefully. Then you come up with a good design. Then you implement it well with things that are quality and that last, and there's some little tricks to that. And then your maintenance should be a lot easier.
Can we go look at the garden?
You bet.
All right. Okay, I'm dating myself here. Very interesting. This is one of the, this pink tag here is something that Owen put on to tell his guys that this is one of the plants that comes out. I think it's also a nice subtle color combination with the pink hibiscus. He's accessorizing nicely. But there's a few reasons for this to come out. I think personally, as I look at this aesthetically, we've got a landscape with a lot of sort of California native plants, things that look very appropriate up here in the foothills. And the hibiscus is sort of in the Gilligan's Island type of approach. So even aesthetically, it looks out of place to me. But it's one of those problem plants in our climate that just doesn't seem to work here. We're all familiar with whitefly and what it takes to try to eradicate that. Although this isn't
Billy,
a terrible case.
Listen,
yes,
you forgot something.
Yes, what's that?
There's one more important thing about this plant. And one of the reasons that we took it out,
and
it's, we call it ugly. It's a technical term.
Ah.
So if you'll excuse me.
Let me out of here.
Yeah. I'm going to get this thing.
This is another one of Owen's pink flag specials. And to me, this is one of those really tough decisions. The plant is fabulous. It's a Toyon, which is a California native. I see it as being very appropriate with the sycamore trees we have around here. Good choice. The difficulty is that right behind me is the deck. And for this plant to not cut off this fabulous view of the ocean and the Channel Islands, it has to be constantly maintained.
One of the key concepts in sustainable landscaping is the idea of right plant, right place, and more importantly here, giving things room to grow. Every plant has a genetic destiny, and the plant really doesn't care about you or me. It's going to do what it's going to do. And so if it's programmed to get 100 feet tall, it's going to do that. And if you needed a 6-foot tall plant, you're going to have trouble with that plant, and you're going to have to keep cutting it back forever because the plant will not learn. So the idea is to create a space for something that's equal to the size that it's going to get at maturity. So what we have here is a Fermanodendron, which gets 10 to 15 feet eventually and will fill this space. We've got some grasses that are smaller, ground covers that will spread out to about 6 feet, and they're planted about 6 feet apart. We've got a Teucrium that is going to get about 5 to 6 feet in diameter. The bush poppy will get 8 to 10 feet. And if you come back in a year or two, this whole thing will be filled in with plants and it'll look very beautiful. The other advantage to doing that, by the way, is it doesn't cost you as much. We've got maybe 20 plants in here where a lot of people would put in 30, 40, 50, or 100 plants thinking, I've got to have this now. You're going to have to live with these plants forever. And because of the fact that they're going to grow in, stabilize, and then stop there, they're not going to ask very much of you in terms of care. With a little bit of planning up front, you can have a much better result for years to come.
When we look at choosing plants for a sustainable garden, we often talk about Mediterranean plants or plants that are adapted to Mediterranean climates. They're hot summers, dry summers, and sort of mild, wet winters. And any of the plants that come from that same sort of environment are well adapted to our climate. So they tend to be water conserving and find their way into our gardens very nicely. The plants that are behind me right now are all Mediterranean climate plants. And although it's not a garden that's really showing off a lot of flowers, one way of creating interest with these sorts of plants is to use different foliage colors, different forms of plants. The sage behind me adds the real floral color to this composition and is a plant that is now at its full size, but it's also a plant that's going to be cut completely to the ground in the wintertime, completely regenerate itself. Whereas the plants behind it, the licorice plant with those soft sort of silvery leaves, is a plant that's just going to continue to spread and sort of wander around. But by allowing these contrasts and the plants to be spaced as they are here to achieve their full size, it really reduces your maintenance, lets the natural character of the plant come out.
The Santa Barbara County Landscape Watering Calculator is an easy-to-use tool that helps you estimate the right amount of water to give your landscape or garden. The calculator has been designed to give you a weekly irrigation schedule for your landscape. All you need to know is your zip code, the type of plant, the soil type, and the sprinkler type for each station on your irrigation system. Go to sbwater.org.
Let's talk a little bit about sun and shade in the garden. I've got this flax, lily turf, tree fern, bamboo. They're all doing very nicely in the dappled shade of this tree over
Billy,
my head.
Billy, hey, I was just at the nursery and I found this great plant and I really liked it and I was thinking maybe we could put it in the bed here.
This plant here, it's a beautiful plant. I think it would look nice in here, but this really requires deep shade. This bed here gets a little bit of hot sun in the afternoon. This thing's gonna fry. Don't ever bring me another plant like this again. This part of the landscape is a very different type of room. It's off the side of the bedroom. It's a quiet space, probably just sit here, read a book. So in this particular place, and again, because there isn't a lot of sunshine, so it's not the ideal place for growing a lot of real flowery, showy plants, the composition is all based on foliage texture and contrast, interesting building materials.
What a lovely collection of plants. We have mando grass and asparagus fern and...
No, seriously, folks. There's a great selection of plants in here. Sometimes you're in a situation where you're not quite sure how sunny it'll be, how shady it'll be. Certain times of the day it's in full sun. Other times it moves into shade. There's a few plants here that do it all. This mando grass will take a considerable amount of sun, as long as it's kept a little moist. This aeonium is a real sun lover, but also gets by in bright shade. Asparagus fern, you can put it just about anywhere but deep shade. That's kind of it. We've got some nice stuff here. So, yeah, what I see here are plants that I know are, like, notoriously great for growing in full sun. You've got plants like Mexican sage and lavender and grasses and that sort of thing. So when you started putting the plant palette together, I would imagine certain plants that you might want to see here, you would look at it and say, well, no, I better not put that here because.
Right.
So how do you?
Well, and it's an interesting question because there actually are some plants here that will make the leap between one zone and the other. The California fuchsia that we saw in both places with the red flower, it's in bloom right now, can take sun or shade. There aren't too many plants that do that, especially blooming ones.
Those to me are really precious plants because from a design point of view, when you're trying to create some harmony where there's a repetition of an element from one place to another, if you have a plant that can be in a few different places, then that sort of becomes your repeating theme that can move around.
It's a bridging plant that carries you from one area to the other. Well, this is a pretty shady area here. It doesn't get a lot of sun. There's a little bit in the afternoons. And so we had to pick plants that were adapted to the light conditions. We wanted to do a pretty much all native planting here and keep it in harmony with the oak trees that are above us, creating the shade. So we used a native sunflower called Vanegasia that is native just to Santa Barbara County.
When we start the planting process and before we really make any decisions about what plants to put where, it's important to understand how to use the entire site and how to get the most of it. In an area like this where you just want to relax, it's nice to have the sense of openness. A lot of low-growing plants, cheery colors, a lot of textural interest and that sort of thing. So it's a very nice situation to have this type of restful little room right in the middle of this somewhat native and idyllic vegetation. The deck here is a little bit more of a formal feel. It's adjacent to the house, so all of the entertainment and living activities make sense out here. It's really just an extension or an outdoor room of the rest of the house. Behind me there's a dining set, just like you might find inside the house. There's a barbecue here that's the equivalent of your kitchen. There's even a nice little water feature bringing us some sound. Although the rest of the site is done in more of sort of a native and rustic type of planting, it's perfectly all right in close to have plants that aren't necessarily from that palette. So things like ivy geranium and bulbs and gazanias and herbs and things like that make perfect sense here. So leave yourself an opportunity before you start picking plants, planning out locations, to understand how you're going to use a space and how to use plants to help fortify what you want to do there.
There are a number of different kinds of shade, and it's not just as simple as sun plants and shade plants. For example, here we've got an area that's what I would call dappled shade. It's got little bits of sunlight coming through it from the canopy of the trees. Sometimes the canopy is very high, sometimes it's low. Farther into the canopy, you'll see that the shade becomes denser and it becomes full shade. There's also shade at different times of the day. Morning shade, afternoon shade are very different from one another because they come at different heat periods in the day. Morning shade comes in the cool weather of the morning, and the afternoon shade comes when the day has gotten hot and the plants could use a little relief from that. And there's also a variation in shade as the seasons change. And so in winter, the sun is lower in the sky, and the shade line moves out from whatever's casting it. And so you get a much longer pool of shade behind a building or under a tree. These things are all important when you're thinking about how to develop a planting scheme. They're also important when you think about where to put patios, decks, seating areas. And so seasonal variations, day-to-day variations, time of the day, and the type of shade being cast are all considerations when you're doing your site analysis, and they make a big difference in how the garden actually works. This is an interesting property. We've got a difficult soil type here.
When you say difficult soil, what do we have up here?
Well, a lot of it's rock, and what isn't rock is a fairly sterile clay soil that is going to be very difficult to get plants to grow well in.
Our fabulous adobe soil.
Pretty much, and we have to adapt the plants to the soil because you can't change the soil.
If I were in that situation as a designer and somebody said I just have to have azaleas or some other plant that really isn't the key well-adapted plant, I think we can always make some concessions. Maybe the azaleas go in a pot, or you go to heroic measures to find just the right spot where the azaleas would have the best chance and allow people to have a few of those treats, but do it in a really concentrated way so it's the most intelligent way of using plants that maybe aren't the best adapted to the site.
Well, one of the first things that we need to think about is the soil, because the plants are going to grow in it. We're going to build things like this retaining wall on top of the soil or in the soil. You can test your soil by squeezing it together and seeing how well it holds together. If I did this and it just fell apart, it would be sand or sandy soil. If it got real gummy and stuck to my hands, that would be a clay soil. There's no such thing as a good or bad soil, but you have to know what you have. And it's better to match the plants to the site and to the soil than to try to change the soil to accommodate the needs of plants.
You know, for some landscapes, this is really all the lawn you need, a little postage stamp. It provides some recreational space. You could even throw a little picnic here, play with the dog, wrestle with the kids. Doesn't take a lot of water, doesn't take a lot of fertilizer if you're using any, and it doesn't take a long time to mow, although, no, I hear the mowing crews coming. I better get out of here. This could get dangerous.
Well, this is a mini meadow. It's a substitute for a traditional mowed lawn. And the plant that we're using here is a native sedge called Carex panza. And it'll look pretty much like lawn if you mow it. But there's a couple neat things about it. One is that you don't have to mow it. You can just leave it like this. And you don't need a lawnmower, and you don't need to go through all that. It uses about half the water of a regular conventional lawn and about half the fertilizer. It looks really neat. The irrigation on this is a sprinkler system, which you actually can't see right now. The heads are buried throughout the area here. And it comes up and sprays overhead just like a regular turf system. It's on an automatic controller, so it doesn't come on at inopportune times and, you know, get people wet. And And as far as irrigation goes and hydrozoning, there's some interesting things that happen. Basically, the plants in the sunny areas are going to dry out more rapidly, and so they need to be on a separate valve to get a little deeper watering or more frequent watering, where the shady plants, generally speaking, will stay wet longer because they're not getting so much sun.
Now, here's something I find a lot of people have trouble with. They say, well, all of the shade plants need a lot of water. It's like, oh, those are the azaleas and the fuchsias and the ferns and things. But it's only logical that in low rainfall climates like ours, there's always going to be shade, and there's always going to be plants that have adapted to shade in that climate. So I think if people do a little bit more research, a little bit of observation, they don't have to just play out of that assumption that if it's shade-loving, it must also be water-loving.
It's really hard to find plants that will flower in the shade, but we've actually got quite a few over there, and they come on at different times of the year, so it's going to be pretty flowery most of the time. We're really not watering that much more than we are in any other part of the garden.
Hi, I'm Kathy Perret with the City of Santa Barbara's Water Resources Specialist. Each episode, we're going to be giving you an irrigation tip. And today's episode, we're going to be discussing hydrozones. Hydrozones are the different watering needs for different types of plants in your garden. As you can see, we have low watering need plants over here versus a high watering use plant, which is your lawn. This is a low water using plant, so it's a low water using drip zone. As you can see down in here, we have individual emitters. Some of these can be anywhere from a half a gallon a minute up to 3 gallons a minute. And you can see that they're dripping. It's a very small amount of water that comes out of these. It's a slow absorption rate into the soil. It's perfect for low water using plants. This is the most water efficient way to water your flower beds along the back fences, around your front areas, anywhere that you want to have some landscaping that's efficient with water use. We're here on a slope, as you can tell. We're in the midst of some low water using, more spreading ground cover out here. We're going to use a drip zone out here just as well. What you want to try and take into consideration is that you want a slow amount of water, very low volume, to be put up on this hillside so that it doesn't run off. What you're going to do is utilize your clock, use your programs. Different types of terrain on different programs on your irrigation controller. This hillside, it's best to have a little water put on it, let it absorb into there, have that controller go back and cycle through again. That's called cycle and soak. You want it to water a little bit, soak in, run around the rest of your programs, come back and water this hillside again. As you can see, we have a high water using lawn zone on now. A lot more water than what you saw the drip zone putting off. These pop-up sprinklers, very, very common. Most lawns have them. Put off about a gallon a minute per sprinkler. So what you're going to want to do is make sure that when you put your lawn zone on, that you put it on a separate program on its own zone, separate from the drip zones that you've got, so you can personalize and customize that schedule to go on the days that you want for the amount of time that the lawn needs. As you can see, there's a little bit more to watering than meets the eye. For assistance, check out the watering calculator on sbwater.org or call your water district for a free irrigation checkup.
Little Kevin had a bad habit of wasting water, taking long showers, not turning the water off while brushing his teeth, and running the washing machine for every single white sock. One day, Kevin's father got the mail. When he opened the water bill, he was flabbergasted. Then a magical fairy appeared and told them to go to the internet to discover ways of saving water. And they lived happily ever after.
I'm here at Alice Keck Park Memorial Garden, the jewel of the crown of the Parks and Recreation System. And it's also a great example of all of the things we've talked about today. Right plant, right place, different areas of sun and shade, different water uses or hydrozones, and we've got a lot of different soil types here. So we invite you down walk your way around the garden. There's an informative sign here regarding low water using plants, and there's even a great plant list of a lot of the plants here at Alice. So we invite you down, have a good time, learn a little, enjoy the park. The next step, this is one everybody's eager to get started on, is picking out plants, but you need a little bit of patience there too. Start by looking at what the plants can do for you. Think about the function of the plant. Do you need shade in a certain area? If you want shade, you're going to plant a big tree that'll cast shade, maybe on this patio that we're sitting in. Or if you need to screen a view, we need plants that form those functions.
Look at the plants that you have, the existing site features. Begin to categorize, make a list of problems, issues, and things you want. What do you want to achieve with this garden? And begin to develop what we call a bubble diagram, which you can do on paper and or in your mind. And it's simply a mark that says patio here, barbecue here, lawn here, etc. And once you get to that point, then you can do a more specific plan that shows exactly where things go.
Once you understand what types of plants you need in each location, the next step is to figure out what size those plants need to be. And I like to think of the landscape in terms of low. Those are plants that are about knee-high or lower. Medium size, maybe up to your shoulders. And then the tall plants. Add to that the trees. And just try to imagine the property with either high, medium, or low plantings in them. Once you've got that done, you start arranging a list of plants and trying to understand where they're going to grow best. So you go back to the idea of the site analysis. If you know an area is going to be hot and sunny, it doesn't matter how beautiful a plant is. If it can't take those conditions, it's not going to be successful there. So once we match the plants to the growing conditions, we think a little about hydro zones and groupings. The last thing is really to have the fun with the aesthetics. Think about the overall shape or architecture of the plant. If it has light-colored or dark-colored leaves, if it's upright or spreading, look at the flower color and try to create interesting combinations. And I think once you put all these pieces together in this order, you're going to end up with a beautiful, functional, sustainable garden. Before you go, we want to give you three important tips, things that you can do this weekend. First, start an idea file. What does that mean? Go through books, steal magazines from your dentist's office, look at gardens that you like, dream about plants, visit some gardens, start putting your own concepts together on what your ideal garden is going to look like.
Tip number two, spend some time in your garden.
Your coffee, sir.
Ah, thank you. You know, one of the best design tools is very simple. It's a chair. You can use it to sit down, relax, get comfortable, and move around different locations in the garden and really get to know the place that you're working with.
Tip number three, find three plants in your garden, like this sea thrift, the crane's bill, the enameled leaf philodendron. Look them up in your Sunset Garden book. Learn a little bit more about them. Find out why they're doing well or why they're not doing well, okay? Enamel leaf philodendron. I don't know if that's in here. So thanks for joining us this week. Hope you learned a few things that you can apply to your own gardens.
So as the sun sets on this proud land and these happy people, we bid you a sustainable farewell.